Hello, this is the third video in a short series. We're building an identity server for Linux with async await. At this point, we have a TCP server that can accept multiple concurrent connections. For each connection, it reads a one-line query from the client and parses it. If parsing fails, it returns an error message and disconnects. If parsing succeeds, well, it needs to answer the query, and that's what we're going to implement today. By the end of this video, the server should actually work. As I said back in part one, the server's job is to reveal which user is responsible for creating a specific TCP connection. We have three pieces of information to work with: the remote address of the computer who's asking, and the source and destination ports from the query. These three things together will uniquely identify a TCP connection if it exists. The easiest way to get a username from that is to take advantage of an existing command line tool like LSOF. So when we receive a query, what we're going to do is set up some command line arguments, run the LSOF process asynchronously, and then parse the output of that program to get the information we need. What I'm actually doing with LSOF is kind of a long story, so I'm going to skip to the end and show you the command that we're going to run. Here I'm going to establish a TCP connection to port 22 on localhost. Now that it's running, I should be able to look it up with LSOF. This bundle of lines, starting with a P, represents a connection. The remote IP and the remote port are used as a filter up here in the arguments. This is the connection's local port. If this matches the one in the query, that means this is the connection that we're looking for. If we get a match, this username above it, TK, is the answer to the query. All right, let's get this going in Rust. I'm going to be using this Tokio struct called command. It has builder methods that I can use to give it command line arguments. For now, I'm going to use this very easy to use output feature. This will run the program to completion, bundle up standard output and standard error as vecuate, and give it to me all at once. Okay, let me add the code that calls the process. Here's the code that sets up the command. The first thing I have to do is construct the filter argument using the remote port and IP. Formatting the IP is kind of fiddly thanks to IPv6, so I've put it into a separate function that I'm not going to talk about. I build up all the same arguments that I used earlier at the shell. Finally, I call output and await on that, which pauses this task while the program runs. When it returns, I get a struct that contains both standard error and standard output. It's unlikely but technically possible that LSOF could return non-UTF-8 data. If this happens, I could return an error and shut down the connection. Instead, I'm just going to use from UTF-8 lossy. This means I'm guaranteed to have a valid string to work on. If it contains nonsense, well, I'll just put up with that. It shouldn't ever happen. For now, I'm just printing the stringified output to the console on the server. So let's test this first. I'll run the server there. Here I'll establish a connection on port 22 just so there's something running. And now I'm going to send in a query, see what's running on port 22. Okay, we sent in a query. LSOF found an entry that matches the remote IP and port. The local port in the query isn't the same as the one in LSOF's output, so this wouldn't have been a match. When this situation occurs, our server is supposed to respond with a no user error. Instead, you can see it just disconnected. So there's a parsing function that I need here. It needs to take LSOF's output and the local port that we're looking for. It should return an option string. Either it finds a matching username or it doesn't. Let me add that code now. Here's a function that works. There is nothing async about it at all. That's because the output function gave me all of the output at once in a buffer in memory. This is fine because LSOF runs quickly and the total amount of data returned is small. Now I can break it into lines and iterate on that. But you know, what if there was a lot of output data, say too much to keep in memory at once? Or what if the underlying process was slow to run and we wanted to start parsing lines as soon as it started emitting them? In these situations, waiting to have all the output at once would be suboptimal. Even though we don't really need to, let's try modifying this command and parser to read LSOF's output line by line asynchronously. If I call spawn instead of output, I get a child process. This has a standard output that I can access, which implements async read. Maybe that sounds familiar from the part 2 video. I can use lines codec again to turn this into something that I can read one line at a time asynchronously. Now, instead of bringing all the program's output into memory and then processing it, I can start processing lines as soon as they're available. This all looks very similar to the old parsing code, except that it's an async function and I'm using .await on each line. Eventually, it either finds a username or it doesn't, and it resolves that future by returning a value. Now, I stop the process early, if required, and make sure it's finished running. At this point, I either have the username or I don't. I need to send one of two messages back to the client who made the query. Let me make that change. Here is the code that sends the final response. If I have the username, I send this line containing it. If I couldn't find the connection or the username, they get a no user error. These funny looking lines are defined in RFC 1413, by the way. In theory, this server works now. Let's test it out. I'm going to create a fresh connection here. Let's see what port that is. Okay, it's from port 41970 to port 22. Let's try sending that as a query. There we go. Apparently it's from the user TK. Now let's try the wrong port. Okay, user not found. Great. What about the other port being wrong? Again, user not found. Perfect. So this is basically done now. If I ran this as root and changed the port to 113, it would be a legitimate identd that can tell you who's responsible for a given connection. That said, there was one part of the RFC that caught my eye. It says here, the server should close the connection down after a configurable amount of time with no queries. A 60 to 180 second idle timeout is recommended. This program does not do that. As long as the client holds the TCP connection open, we'll wait forever for a query. Perhaps this is something to explore next time. Until then, cheerio.